saw one performance area that I could see causing a potential problem would be the changing rooms, but it's just due to the fact that they're not very big. So the scene that takes place within the changing rooms, it's the smell scene, where the whole thing is based upon the smells that match the pre-recorded script that we're going to do in order to create an uncomfortable atmosphere. So in order to make it a more effective scene, what we wanted to do is we wanted to darken the room to be able to enhance the senses of the audience, but obviously due to the lack of room, we could end up causing a potential problem. So what we're going to do is we want to have 10 audience members, and each member is going to be seated within a chair. So we need to work out the best way to place them whilst also having the space for us as the performers to be able to move about the room and to make sure that all the audience members are fully engaging in the scene by smelling everything that's mentioned in the script. So we actually did a test run of the scene, which was proven quite difficult, but it wasn't really anything to do with the seating arrangements, because at the time when we actually ran it, we only used about 5 people. So obviously for the actual one, we're going to have to work out how to seat everybody, because we're going to have double the amount of people. But for the first run through, it was just the smells really, because people weren't being able to smell the smells as effectively as what we'd hoped that they would. So I think it's a case of either getting things that smell stronger or just taking our time more. So not rushing to get round everybody, just taking your time, because there's plenty of time in the script. It's just you feel like you've got to rush because you know there's something else coming up, but we just need to take our time. But in the actual performance as well as doing that, we do need to work on the seating plan, because there's going to be double the amount of people in. So we need to make sure that, obviously with it being dark as well, that everybody's seated nice and safely, there's going to be no injuries. We're able to get around without like bumping into things, falling over. We need to be able to actually get that our smells as well, to be able to like swap them over from a walk around to engage the audience. So we need to think about all of them different things. Another problem area could be the lift. So although there isn't actually a full scene happening within the lift, it's going to be used as a way to guide the audience from one floor to the other. So if something happens, so somebody was to press the button for the lift, it would mean they aren't able to guide the audience, and there might be a bit of an awkward wait within the performance. So it can end up meaning that the actors are going to have to just start improvising until the lift actually comes. And although it could be a potential issue within the performance, it's not actually going to be on until the evening, so hopefully there won't be many people in the building anyways. It'll mainly just be us and our audience. But if something was to happen like that, you've just got to try and turn it into a positive. So think, if something's going to go wrong, how can you make something good come from it? So it will actually be a good chance for the actors to improvise and to create more of an uncomfortable atmosphere before actually getting the audience into the lift, because if they want to stand there and say things to the audience and make them feel really uncomfortable, they've then got to lead them into a confined space, so they might even end up being a bit reluctant to get into the lift to make the performance more effective. So my role within the show is a performer, so as well as being in my own scenes, because I'm in the Starbucks scene, the photography studio and the smell scenes, I'm also in like full cast ones, so the conference room and the wrap party. And I've also been taking part in sound design, overlapping sounds and recording audio. And although I know what I need to do personally, rehearsing is the key, and I think it's important to run through things and to gain feedback from test audiences and from the rest of the group. And as a group as a whole, I feel like we just need to keep on top of rehearsals and try new things, as opposed to having disagreements and just thinking, oh well, that's not going to work, that's not going to work. We need to just keep on rehearsing, and if somebody's not in, just rehearse your scene or go over your script or do something different, watch somebody else's, give them feedback. And I think we just need to keep on working on it, as opposed to just being really negative and thinking that things aren't going to work, or thinking that we need to rely on one person for the whole performance to be able to rehearse, and thinking, oh, if this person isn't in, we can't do it. And I think it's also really important to watch each other's scenes and to discuss areas for improvement and give each other constructive feedback, because as a group we are like, we fully understand the meaning behind the performance because we've done the research and we've planned the whole thing. So because we know how the performance is supposed to go, we need to be able to give each other feedback to make sure that the message is coming across in the way that we want it to. One void that would be in the performance would be going up the stairs after the Starbucks scene. So walking the audience through the corridor and up 2 flights of stairs, it is quite a long walk, so it's important to find a way to, first of all, actually get them to walk through the corridor and up the stairs, but secondly, to be able to keep them engaged within the performance. So I think one thing that we were planning on doing is we were going to pre-record a bit of script in the audio, so when they're actually walking through the corridor and up the stairs, it leads on from the scene before. So in the Starbucks scene where it's going to be me and Jake, I think. So what we were going to do is, because Jake's going to be yelling and trying to be really controlling and demanding and saying, oh, get upstairs, do this, do that, we were going to try and record that, like, but also like a bit of a struggle. So as we disappear up the stairs and then the audience follow on, we want to keep them engaged, so they're really curious as to what's going to happen when they get to the top of the stairs. Like, will we be there? Will something have actually happened? Will they be in a different scene? We want them to, like, have questions going as they're walking up the stairs. And we also don't want them to be walking up the stairs just, like, having a chat to each other, just not really thinking about it. We want them to be properly engaged in the whole performance, even the areas where the actors might not even be there. So even if they're alone for a couple of seconds, we don't want them to start, like, talking to each other and getting really distracted. We want them to be fully engaged in the whole thing. And another thing that we were thinking about doing is having somebody in Starbucks, like, so after the scene where we've run off, to treat the audience as if they're actually part of the actual performance. So it'll be like, oh yeah, if you just want to come this way, just ignore that. Oh, that kind of stuff happens all the time, don't worry, she's new. We want them to feel like they're actually part of the performance, so as if they're going on like a tour of the building. So another void would be in the theatre when we're trying to get the audience to go into the light in the middle of the room. So although they might resist, I think, although it will be quite obvious where they've got to go, but we can always encourage them by maybe having somebody guide them into the room from the last scene, or just being like, oh yeah, if you just want to stand there, or if we're in like a circle but we leave like around the light but we leave a gap, it might be a bit obvious that they've got to like walk in the middle of us. So in order to guide the audience through the performance, we're going to cover the corridor lights with red filters in order to engage and entice them into what's going to be coming next, because we want to create that atmosphere. We don't want them to just walk through the corridor and just have the normal lights on, just as if it's just a normal day in the building. We want them to feel like there's actually something happening, or like they're in like a different kind of environment, so they feel like the story's leading on. But I feel like lighting also isn't always effective, because in the last scene in the theatre during the rehearsals, we didn't run the scene, but we just did like a little bit of a test to see if the audience would actually react to the different light. And certain people were a bit reluctant to go into the light without the encouragement from us. So when they walked in, there was like, we had like a spotlight, and then there was lights on different things that were happening, and it was a case of trying to get them to go to where the light was, but some of them weren't really too sure about it because it wasn't a proper performance or anything, so it might just be because of that, but they're a bit unsure of where to go. So we're going to use sound throughout the whole performance, because every scene needs some kind of audio. So it's going to be used to fill voids, so in the corridor and going up the stairs. So after the Starbucks scene, we're going to have pre-recorded audio playing in there to try and keep the audience engaged. And in all the different scenes, we're going to be using it as well. So there's the breakdown scene, there's going to be pre-recorded sound in there. In the smell scene, there's going to be a script that's also pre-recorded in there, but that one's quite different because that one's going to be based upon the smell. So when people are actually seeing things on the pre-recorded script, the audience are also going to get the sense of smell at the same time, so they need to both work together. Also within the recording studio, so we're going to have an actual singer, so the sound in there is going to be a live performance. In the theatre, that's going to be, we're going to have different R. Kelly songs playing. So we chose R. Kelly because obviously he's been convicted of sexual abuse, and it really helped, the Me Too movement helped like lots of different victims come forward. So we're going to have his music playing, and we're going to see if people will actually like dance and sing and stuff. And then on top of that, we're also going to have the sound from the videos playing. So obviously we're going to have like a song, then a song, then a video, just to see like different people's reactions. So will they keep on dancing after their videos played if another song comes on? There's also the photography studio, which is going to be quite good. So we're going to have the use of the two separate rooms. So the audience are going to be in a smaller room looking into the photography studio. And then we're going to make it so all of a sudden they're able to hear the audio from what the people are actually seeing in the photography studio. And then when they actually go into the other room, we're going to have a set of headphones. So it's like you can hear Alex's thoughts and what he's going to be thinking. So you can kind of make up your own idea of what his character's actually like without him having to actually say something. We used a few different things throughout the performance, obviously to immersive theatre, but we also used things such as him hands and sensory performance as well. So the five senses, they're going to be represented in different ways throughout the performance. So for example, smell, That's an essential one because obviously we've got a scene that's fully dedicated to the different smells that match the pre-recorded script. Obviously making the script come to life and allowing the audience to feel as if they're actually a part of it. And the sense of smell is important in the sense that the audience are actually going to gain something from the scene and that they smell the things that we're hoping to use. Otherwise there wouldn't be a point in doing it because if we just sat them in a room and we just played the audio, they wouldn't really gain much from it. Whereas with the actual smells, with it being dark, they've just got that own imagination as to what's actually going around. So they can be picturing themselves in that scenario with all these different smells going on. So that's how we're going to use that one. Touch is going to be used, especially within the conference scene, because we're going to seat the audience down, and in the scene it's based around the touching of the audience and making them feel as uncomfortable as possible, but without pushing the boundaries too far. So we're going to like stand over them, we're going to like play with the hair, stroke the arms, just to make them feel like really on edge. Sight, obviously that's going to be used throughout the performance, because the audience need to observe the show, and in certain situations, to make them think like, in a sense of, if I'd actually seen that in real life, would I do something about it now that I know how uncomfortable it is? So, in the conference room where some audience members are going to be seated but some are going to be standing, the ones who were standing, and they're basically just observing what's going on, but would that actually in real life, if they'd seen something like that going on, would they say something about it now they know, like, how it's made them feel? One sense that won't actually be used as much will be taste, but that's because we're not actually getting the audience to eat anything. However, within certain rooms, such as the smell scene, the script does actually mention about things such as strawberry cream chocolates. So obviously within a dark environment, they're open to use their imagination to imagine what the taste might actually be like. So that could be a use of taste there. And hearing, obviously throughout the whole performance we're going to have different things going on, so different audios, different sound effects, tracks, singing, music, we're going to have loads of different things going on, obviously spoken word, pre-recorded scripts, so sound is a major thing within the performance. So the role of the story within the performance is to educate people about the Me Too movement and to raise awareness of sexual abuse within the performing arts industry. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to educate the audience on the abuse that goes on behind the scenes and the effect it can have on someone's mental health. And in order to educate them, we wanted to use the storyline to be able to create an uncomfortable piece of theatre that obviously pushes the boundaries and makes uncomfortable atmospheres, because I feel like if we're going to be straight to the point about what we're trying to do, it's the best way to do it, to make the audience fully understand and become immersed in the storyline, because if you just go for it like, and it's just like half-assed, and the audience aren't really going to be as interested in it, whereas if you properly go for it, you make them uncomfortable, you have all these different unexpected things going on, and you just make them feel a sense of like awkwardness. Like, I feel like that's the best way to do it, because then they might actually really start to understand that this kind of stuff actually does go on in real life. So technology is going to be used throughout the performance in many different ways. So the use of sound technology is going to be used to immerse and guide the audience through voids, and light and filters will also be used within the corridors to create a tense atmosphere. And the use of sound technology is going to be really important when it comes to scenes such as the rap party at the end, because obviously in there we've not only got actual music playing, but we've got like videos as well. So obviously we've got the audio from the videos, and we've got like the actual screens that are going to be playing them. So it's going to be like a song, a video. So that's quite a lot of technology that we need to use as well. And we're going to be using different laptops in different rooms. So in rooms where we need like music or pre-recorded scripts or audios or anything, we're going to have loads of different laptops and iPads in different rooms that are all connected up. And we're going to have like obviously speakers in the corridors and things like that. And I think we're also in one scene, in the breakdown scene, we're also going to have just like a wireless speaker as well, like a Bluetooth one. So we've got loads of different things going on. So as our performance is an immersive theatre show, the fourth wall between the actors and the audience is completely broken. And although we don't use the fourth wall and we interact with the audience in a lot of the scenes, we still do have certain scenes where they are just there as observers. So for example, the breakdown scene, the audience are there just as a viewing audience as opposed to being directly involved. And then within the conference scene, half of the audience is seated, whereas half of them are standing as onlookers. So obviously that's to give them a sense of what would they do if they knew that somebody was in that situation? Like, would they just stand there and watch it happen, or would they do something about it? So half of the audience in that scene are just there as a viewing audience. A lot of the scene, the fourth wall is broken because we want the audience to feel involved, and we want to make them feel uncomfortable because the issue that we're trying to portray within the audience is real life. So we want people to go away and actually think about it, and the fact that if they felt really uncomfortable during the performance, what would people feel like who've actually been affected by it? We want them to think about that. So if they felt like so uncomfortable during the performance, that's just acting, that's not even real life. So we want them to actually think about it, and hopefully it'll get them thinking. So the audience need to be aware of the type of performance that we're intending to put on, so they can decide for themselves whether it's for them or not. And for the health and safety of both the performers and the audience, we need to make sure that they're aware that it's an immersive theatre show and that they might potentially be involved in certain scenes. There's also going to be an age restriction on the performance and a warning of the intention of the storyline, so if someone has been directly affected, they know not to come to watch the show because it could upset them. And the audience also need to make sure that they're listening, that they don't try to rush ahead of the show, because if they're going to be guided like up flights of stairs and into dark rooms, they need to be made aware of potential hazards and also follow through with the performance when they're instructed to do so. So if they get told to go from one room to another, to only go when they've actually been taught to do so. Because although we do want them to have some sense of control and to feel like they're part of the performance, we need them to think about their own safety as well, so not just sending them into a dark room on their own. So we need to actually have them make sure that they're not rushing ahead. So in the rehearsal process, I feel like we, like as a whole group, made it quite difficult for ourselves. So for example, if somebody was off, rather than running through other scenes or reading through a script or watching each other and giving constructive feedback, it was more of a case of we can't do that because that person isn't in. But also spent a lot of time planning and worrying and stressing about the scenes, so I don't feel we actually gave ourselves enough rehearsal time actually going through them, because we spent more time worrying about what was going to go wrong as opposed to actually just trying things. And I think we also found it quite difficult to rehearse without an audience, because certain scenes, it felt like you did need the audience there in order to see whether the scene was actually going to work or not. And with scenes such as the Starbucks scene, it was quite hard to rehearse due to the fact that obviously it isn't open space, so people sit there for their dinner or to do their work or to relax. So obviously we couldn't really go screaming in Starbucks every week and dragging each other around. And personally, I also think that I should have tried to do more research into the Me Too movement and try to embody the character more, because as somebody who hasn't been directly affected by it, in order to give a believable performance, I think I should have researched and rehearsed more than what I actually did. I do, however, think that I had a good understanding of where I had to be and what I had to do and when, but I just needed to show more characteristics.